Hello, everyone. Welcome back. My name is April Butcher. I'm your mother on social. And I couldn't give you guys a little common sense commentary when it comes to things happening in the world, in pop culture, and in these internet streets. So if they interest you, definitely hit that subscribe button, like this video, and let's get into the caca. So I have been missing in action for the last couple of weeks. And although my better half said that he was going to take over, it was a bit overwhelming even for him. I thank him for the time that he did step in. Thank you to Mr. B. But it was just too overwhelming for him. And he didn't want to add any more extra stress to me. So I just decided to just take a break, reset, and come back. So we're back today. And I wanted to come on and talk to you guys about this whole entire Brandy Hellville situation. I found out about it through social media all this weekend. It has been going viral all over TikTok and Instagram. And I decided to go on and watch this documentary. So this is a documentary on the clothing brand Brandy Melville. Now, these stores are still open despite the, you know, documentary coming out and the current litigations and lawsuits going on against Brandy Melville and their, like, I guess, old employees. So I want to come on and just give you guys some common sense to this, because this was just like, my jaw was dropped. Brian and I watched it last night and our jaws were dropped when we finished watching this. I could not believe that not just Brandy Melville, but the amount of, like, how fast fashion is really causing so much disarray around the world. And although a lot of us live here in America and you feel like, oh, well, I'm going to buy from Shein, I'm going to buy from Temu, it doesn't bother me. I'm going to do these reviews on YouTube and on TikTok and Instagram, and I need my money. I need to get to my bag. And after watching that last night, my jaw was utterly dropped. And it's amazing to me how so much in America, we get so disconnected to what's going on around the world, what's going on in other countries. And I feel like a lot of times we need to, like, take a look in the mirror and really adjust our spending and adjust our buying as such. Now, for those of you that are following me on Instagram and TikTok, you know I share my daily finds in Marshalls and TJ Maxx and things like that, things that I'm actually buying, consuming, and using. And for me, that's the way I'm choosing to go as far as being a creator, not so much an influencer, because we're going to talk about that in another video when we talk about Coachella, because I'm going to be breaking that down. But not so much as an influencer, but more as a tastemaker. Okay. So for me, when I saw this documentary about Brandy Hellville, that's the name of the documentary, honey, on HBO Max. My jaw was dropped. Now let's get into it. Brandy Melville, I know back in 2017 to 2019-ish, a lot of women were into the whole boho fashion, okay? Damn near looking like a grandma, looking like somebody that just woke up out the bed. This whole entire boho fashion was taking over Pinterest, Instagram at the time. We didn't have TikTok during that time, but definitely Instagram, Pinterest was ruling boho fashion, okay? Nothing I was never interested in, but it was taking over the waves, mainly in the space of Caucasian women. Now, if you watch the documentary, you will see that Brandy Melville specifically hired young Caucasian girls to be in their store working, being influencers online, and basically all of the other races, you know, people like Black people, Asian, Indian, Hispanic, they all worked in the basements in the stock rooms. That blew my mind, okay? That in 2020, 2021 to 2024 now, that they are still doing this. They are still practicing this within their company and their brand. What blew my mind is that everything goes through the CEO, the person that is running the company, some man named Stefan. The way that Brandy Melville has came into the forefront of this documentary is the fact of its practices. So let's go through some of the things that were discussed in here that were basically illegal. They would take pictures of the staff and have the staff take pictures of the staff in the clothing, in the Brandy Melville clothing, and have those images sent over to the CEO directly. Not a middleman, not a middle person, not a marketing person, directly. The CEO was asking employees to take pictures of young white girls that were coming into the store buying clothing. So if the girls were in clothing, regardless if it was Brandy Melville clothes or some other type of designer, as long as the girls looked trendy, the CEO wanted the photos.
Leadership, and they would be like normally pretty flattered. Then I would just send it like a regular employee store style to Stefan and Jesse. Quite often, they would respond and say, like, hire her right now if they really liked her. One of the former employees I talked to said that she was working in the New York flagship store, and she came up behind Stefan and she looked over and he had a folder. In the folder was every single one of the photos that she sent over the years for this daily image.
And we'll get into discussion of why he wanted the photos in a little bit and how this ties back into fast fashion and also companies like Kylie. Okay, Kylie's new clothing line. So then on top of that, they had employees that were white women, white young girls working the front, folding the clothes, working the registers. But the black, Hispanic and Asian women had to work down in the stock room. Okay, because that was a basement stock room or a regular stock room. That's where they worked, or they worked in the fitting rooms. And then, and y'all know how the fitting rooms go as far as like when you go to the Gap or Navy, they have somebody there and their job is to either fold them clothes or put them clothes back in the hanger. They're like tucked away in the back corner. You don't ever see them. Think about like when you go into Zara, this long hallway, and there's these girls working in the back, which thinking about it as Zara, they do be doing that. I've seen it here in Las Vegas. I don't know about other places. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I know here in Las Vegas, I see mainly the black girls working Zara's fitting rooms and young white girls and guys working the registers. Comment below if you've seen that also in Zara, because that's an eyebrow raiser also. But also, besides all of that, there was an actual grape, okay, that happened in their company apartment in New York. So there's a lot of things litigation wise going against this company. But what we learned about this man that is running this company, basically what he does is he provides the stock to the actual like franchises, because this is like franchise owned, and he provides the stock to the franchises and the people that are running the franchises. And if they don't abide by his rules, then he will not produce any more clothing for them. He will not ship any more clothing to their location. So it was very eye-opening how this one person who is extremely, okay, if you go and you watch the documentary, you will see that he is getting away with this. From a common sense approach, he is getting away with this because he is funding somebody. There's somebody higher up politically that he is funding that is keeping the fire off of him. Because of his views and how he runs his business, something's afoot there, okay? And I hope that this documentary opens up many more channels for people to find out what's really going on behind this company and that it gets shut down at some point. The crazy part about it is, what's so crazy to me about America is that women will watch this documentary, not black women, not Asian women, not Hispanic women. Y'all know what I'm talking about. They will continue to watch this documentary and continue to shop. Even as of recent, the company, like I checked last night when I was watching the documentary, they are still posting on their Instagram. They just went ahead and like are not allowing people to comment. And then also there's still women reviewing their clothing on TikTok. And I'm like, y'all, there are other places to buy cute little clothes similar to Brandy Melville. So here's the thing with that aspect of it and why I feel Brandy Melville is still thriving today. just recently, for those of you that are not following me, over on Instagram, I've been posting a lot of videos about discount finds, like things I'm finding in Marshall's, TJ Maxx, the 99 Cents Only store. And probably about 2 weeks before the 99 Cents Only store decided that they were going to shut their doors and, you know, that whole entire situation, which I have a lot of inside information on the 99 Cents store and why they decided to go about doing it this way. But I was posting content, you guys, on the 99 Cents Only store. And I might come on and say, like, let's say this cup. I got this cup, you know, for the 99 Cents Only store. It's a real good deal. You know, it was X amount of dollars, right? And like $2. And you can't find this anywhere else. This is a bargain. This is a steal. The first post that I posted by the 99 Cents about the 99 Cents Only store, and it was not sponsored. It was just me going in the store and finding out that, like, oh my gosh, they have really great things there, right? The first time I posted them and tagged them, they reposted me. Okay. I was like, wow, they reposted me. It's so many other times that I tag, you know, Marshall's, I tag TJ Maxx, I might tag a beauty brand, and they don't ever repost my stuff. 99 Cents store reposted it like no problem. So I was like, oh, okay. Within, I would say, an hour to 2 hours, the video was already at 8,000 views. So I was like, oh, I'm onto something, or maybe this was a fluke. I don't know. Let's try it again to see if this is just a fluke or this is really working. So I posted another video for the 99 Cents Only store of me finding finds there. They reposted me again. Second time they reposted me within an hour, it was at 7,000 views. So I was like, wow, the 99 Cents store, people shopping here. People like are watching their videos to see what you could find in there. And then for 2 weeks, I did that. And I was growing on Instagram just from posting 99 Cents Only store finds. And what I find about that is, if I'm posting about the 99 Cents Only store and finding really good discount deals there, then my Marshalls, my TJ Maxx videos will do well also, because they're discount store finds, right? People want luxury for a cheaper price. So then the 99 Cents store went out of business and they didn't allow you to tag them anymore. They weren't posting anybody anymore. So as you guys know, they're going bankrupt and they're liquidating everything, right? So I was like, wow, I found a brand that I really liked, that I think people could really find things there that are really useful. And now this, right? So my feeling with Brandy Melville is the fact that they repost people, that the people that are quote unquote influencers are feeling that they're getting some type of acknowledgement for going there and shopping. And also the people that actually follow Brandy Melville and are looking for the cutest outfit or the cutest find will then follow those people or watch that video, which then to that person, it looks like engagement. So for anybody asking, like, why are people still posting their clothes? It's because people are watching, people are buying, and people are supporting. And the brand is reposting those individuals, which then makes them feel like they're getting clout. Okay. So I feel like that's the reason why the brand is still thriving today. Even though they turn the comment section off, there are still girls that are posting their Brandy Melville outfits, right? And then there's a lot of girls in the documentary that I was talking. It was one girl that was striking to me. And she said, yes, I did know that the black girls were working in the stock room and in the fitting rooms, and the rest of us got to work on the floor and get our pictures taken. She was like, we just all kind of like side-eyed it and just like looked the other way. But then when Brandy Melville CEO said he didn't want that same girl that had just said that, he didn't want her working there anymore because she had gained weight and she wasn't the look of the company, then all of a sudden it became a problem. And I feel like that's the problem with our country. If it doesn't affect a person, then they're not worried about it. They're going to continue to buy, they're going to continue to shop. If it does not directly affect their way of life day to day, and whatever it is that they're purchasing or consuming is benefiting them, then it's great. Till it's not great. And the analogy I think about is when you're invited to the party, you're invited into the group, you're invited into the clique. But the minute you're kicked out and you have to look from the outside of the window into the actual space, like imagine yourself being outside of a store and you're benefiting from that store. You benefited from that store. And then eventually they stop carrying your sizes or you start to gain weight and you can't fit what's in that store. That's kind of like what me would express. When I was really young in my 20s, me and Brian used to shop at Express every freaking weekend. We used to shop at Charlotte Russe every freaking weekend. And then when I started to outgrow those clothes, I would just walk by and like window shop what was in the front window, but that was it. I couldn't go in there and find anything my size as I started to get older and gain weight. And actually me and Brian had a conversation about this because I remember when we were first, and our anniversary is this week. Hallelujah. We've been married 17 years. I remember when Brian and I first started dating before we even got married. And I remember going to work on Sundays. So I would go to church Sunday morning with Brian, go to lunch, and then I would leave and go to work. And I would work from 3 to 11. And when I would get home about 11:30, 12 o'clock at night, Brian would have clothes laid out on the bed. I kid you guys not. And these clothes would come from Charlotte Russe. I know like now in 2024, y'all girls want to shop at Valentino. Y'all want to shop at Louis Vuitton. But honey, any clothes was good clothes to me. Okay. So Brian would buy tons of Charlotte Russe. He would go and buy me outfits, y'all. And like for the whole week, we would go to dinner and, you know, go to lunch. And I would always have nice clothes to wear. And all the time, it was like brand new stuff. And then one day I was talking to Brian, this is like a couple years ago. I said, probably about 5 years ago. And I was like, you know, when you're having those discussions and they're kind of like arguments and you're like, you don't do this for me anymore. You don't do that for me anymore. And I was like, you don't even buy clothes for me anymore. I used to come home and there would be clothes laid out, you know, on the bed. And he was just being honest. He said, I'm going to just be honest with you. I don't know your size anymore. Back then, I could just go in the store and know that a size small, size medium would fit you. I could look at it and know. He was like, but I don't want to hurt your feelings because I don't know what size fits. And I don't want to go buy something and then you have to return it. And it makes you sad because I bought something that you fell in love with, but it doesn't fit. And it really hit home because it's not that his intentions change. It's just, baby, his sister done got big. Okay. So I was like, okay, I understand. So I feel like with Brandy Melville, yeah, it's cool when you're in the It crew and you can fit into these clothes. But when you can't anymore and you don't fit the aesthetic of the brand, they boot you out and they fire you. And then in the documentary, they were saying how the CEO only wanted white girls in the store and only wanted white girls on the actual Instagram page. That's all he wanted. And he wanted to take the girls to take pictures of girls coming into the store. And the thing about it is when I was listening to it, I said, are they signing releases to these photos? And where are these photos going? And the girls were saying that there were no releases signed for them to have their images. And that also these images were being sent directly to the CEO. They even showed that he installed video cameras in one of their flagship stores. And he put a red light on the side of the register. And when a customer would come in that he liked, that he was watching from the video camera, the red light would go on and that meant take a picture of that customer at the register. And I'm like, this is so illegal. Like, how is this store even still open? And it's still open because of money. It's honestly money. He's funding somebody. He's funding somebody to get that person to not get the heat put on them, right? So I was like, this is craziness. The other thing that they showed was that one of the girls went and stayed at their apartment in New York, right? And that when they would go to these apartments in New York, there was a man staying in there and something happened to one of the girls and she had to go to the hospital. And when she was needing to file, and I can't say what it is, y'all know what I'm trying to say. When she went to file the police report, they wanted her to file a police report. She said she wouldn't because she was here working on a visa and she didn't want to be sent from this country And she didn't want to lose her job. So she didn't want to, only reason why she came to the hospital was because she knew something had happened. And it turns out something had happened. She had been given something in a drink and y'all know what happened. So the other thing that they talked about, it was a black girl that worked in the stock room. And she had on these really cute pants. And they took a picture of her in her outfit to send to the CEO. Because if they saw something that was cute on someone, they would take a picture of it and send it to the CEO. So this one white girl had did the same thing. She had wore something really cute, a really cute top. And they sent the picture to the CEO, and the CEO got the sweatshops to remake the shirt. And the girl got a $100 bonus for that. So the black girl was like, oh, well, these are cute pants. Why don't y'all take a picture of these pants and send it to them? They sent the picture and she didn't get nothing for it, but they remade the pants. And I was like, wait, what?
My friend Phoebe literally was like, oh, you guys should sell socks. Like, and then they started selling socks. They would ask me to look up clothes on his computer and order them, and then they would remake them.
It happened like a few times. We had stuff that would be recalled because there was an infringement of property rights, and they would get a notice from an attorney, and so they would call and tell me, oh, you have to take all the stuff out.
For a little bit, Jesse was showing me graphics and things like, do you like this? Okay, what about this color? Product research was what they called it.
Like, and so the black girl was like, where is my money? Because she got paid for it and I didn't. There were a lot of like cringy things in this documentary that I don't understand how this company gets away with this. But I think the thing that drove it home for me was the fast fashion aspect of it. Seeing how much fast fashion is being sent to places like Ghana, and how this is the crazy part. I was like, well, why Ghana does it tell these people to stop sending all these clothes here? And the clothes, there's so much waste in clothes that on the side of the beach where the water is coming in and taking these clothes away, they said that the clothes are buried down in the sand at least 8 feet deep down into the sand.
And so we believe that the sea floor around Accra looks exactly like this, if not much worse, because all of the stuff is sunk. And this is not something that we did. It's not something that we caused.
And that this is going into the water. And when the people of Ghana go out to fish, the fish are eating on these clothes. So now it's ingested in the fish and it's just like basically slowly killing the people there in Ghana. And I just couldn't believe it. And they were saying that countries like the US, Canada, I think they mentioned Canada, I'm not for sure. They said the UK, China, they send the fast fashion clothes there that are wasteful, right? Like the extras, the things that didn't sell. They ship it there to Ghana. And you would think like, well, why Ghana doesn't turn it away? Well, apparently, allegedly, according to the documentary, the people said that the country of Ghana, right, that they cannot turn it away because then different countries like the U.S. will put sanctions on the country. They will do different things to the country politically that keeps them from progressing or being able, like they'll put more taxes on them and things like that. It was several things that they mentioned that they will do to the country sanctions wise and politically wise that will have the company hand over fist. So they have to take the clothes in. And I was like, this is utterly crazy. This is utterly crazy because they were saying how, you know, off the coast of Ghana is where a lot of slaves were taken and brought to the U.S. Now, in 2024, they're bringing all of these clothes and importing them into Ghana and the people just can't do nothing about it. So it's just very, very frustrating watching this documentary and watching how much clothes goes to waste and how the people of Ghana have to try to like muster through all of that. The other controversy with the company is that they only have one size. And the motto that they usually use is one size fits small. That's their motto. One size fits small. And they were talking about how he only wanted white women to model his clothes. But then they opened up stores in China. And now in China and Japan, they're wearing the clothes, right? But now the clothes are so tiny and so small that some of the girls there are losing so much weight just so they could fit into the clothes there. So it's just crazy to me that this exists in this world, that why we worried about so many other things here in America or here in the world as a whole, that nobody is seeing that this company is problematic and this company has not been shut down yet. The last thing I want to touch on is basically the made in Italy. So on the clothing, it says made in Italy. And they said they do that in order to make you think that it's prestigious. But like the woman was saying in the documentary, you know, sweatshops are not just in China. They're in LA. They're in different parts of America. They're also in Italy. And there's an area there, and let me pronounce it right, it's called Proto Moda. I think it's how you spell it, how you pronounce it, Proto Moda. And basically they have like these sweatshops there that are like fast fashion sweatshops. And they make mass produce these products. So there's a company there by the name of Manteco. They basically take all of the fast fashion, like leftovers and fabrics, and they refine it by hand and reuse it for companies like Valentino. A lot of the high-end luxury brands like Prada, they utilize the fabrics from Manteco because it's recycled fabric. So I thought that was very ingenious that even in Italy, they're doing it, like they're making it a must that in their country, they cut down on useless fabrics that aren't being used and try to recycle the fabrics and make it more into or make it available to more fashion houses that are high end and allow them to use recycled fabric. So I thought that was a plus. The other thing is there's a foundation called the Or Foundation in Ghana. I'm going to put their information down below, and they are working to do research on how to get Ghana cleaned up and get all of the extra clothes, the fast fashion clothes out of Ghana and stop polluting their, you know, beaches and their waters. And I just don't understand how, like, in 2024, there's such a lack of empathy towards other people, not just in our country, but in other countries that are going through such heinous, these are crimes. These are heinous crimes. And how someone that is Italian living in another country can come in America, open up this company, not paying no taxes. This man is not paying any taxes, and is getting away with this. So basically the way he's getting away with it, in my opinion, from what I'm seeing, is it's his trademark name, Brandy Melville. But what he's doing is he's franchising it out to where people can buy the franchise, right? So me as an American, I buy the franchise. He provides the clothing. He ships the clothing in there. And you as the franchisee buy the clothing from him. But you are still abiding by his rules. He doesn't pay any taxes on the clothes that you're buying from him. But you as the franchisee have to pay the taxes because it's your business. So I just don't understand how a person like this has so much control in this country, taking advantage of young white women in this country, because no matter how people see it, you know, some people might feel like, well, that's them and they dumb self. Like, that's their parents not teaching them and not raising them properly. But at the end of the day, y'all, these are innocent girls. Regardless of what race they are, they are innocent girls being taken advantage of. And nobody deserves this. Like, when they're 16, 18 years old, working at these stores, 20 years old, working at these stores. Like, this one girl explained that one of the young girls that was working, she was working in the front. She was a white girl, and she was trying to Swiffer the floor, but she didn't put the Swiffer little, you know, the little Swiffer sweeper thing that goes on there, the little cloth thing. She was just Swiffing straight plastic to wood floor, to concrete floor. And she was just looking at her like, what are you doing? Like, a lot of these girls are young and impressionable. They don't know anything. Their parents are just letting them run wild and do whatever and not checking on things. But that still doesn't give a person a right to take advantage of an individual. So I just wanted to come on and tell you guys about this documentary. If you've not watched it, definitely check it out. I think it hits home with consumerism and how we purchase things in this world, how we don't look into these companies, how they're operating, how they're treating their staff. And it's just crazy to me. So sound off down below if you've watched the documentary. Let me know what you think. And also going back to the part where they're copying the clothes that the girls have on. That's why now when I look at companies like Kylie doing this fashion line or whatever, I now really wholeheartedly believe that they're ripping off other people's fashions, especially because of this documentary and what it showed about that, that he just takes a picture of an outfit and then sends it to the factory and the factory remakes it and puts it on their website. And that's just like absolutely crazy to me that like people have no morals. All they see is dollar bills. And I just don't understand it in this day and age, how people are still thriving. And then in a sense, I do understand it. It's common sense. People just see green. And the people that are buying these clothes and reviewing them online, all they see is numbers and views. And that's crazy to me. But with that being said, you guys, sign off in the comments section down below. I will be back this week to talk about Coachella. I'm also about to talk about the visuals from Beyonce. I'm also going to be discussing Forever Mood, Jackie Aina's new line of fragrances, and what I think about that. But with that being said, sign off in the comment section down below. Remember to like, comment, and subscribe. Follow me on Instagram and TikTok and Threads. And I will see you guys in the next video. Bye.